Welcome to yet another session of Ethical Issues for Modern Computer Professionals. As you may recall, that the basic principle behind almost all emerging data-driven solutions is automated decision-making. The solutions are augmented or sometimes replacing human decisions in solving problems having direct societal impact. Their applications cover healthcare, employment, housing, policing, and criminal justice, product recommendations, social media services, and many more. Now again, as we have seen already, overall procedure of automated decision making can be divided into two major steps, namely data collection and aggregation, and decision making through data analysis or learning. Irrespective of whether the first step, that is data collection and aggregation, is done complying ethical standards or not, the second step of decision making by analyzing the data may also give rise to several ethical issues. Whereas the ethico-moral issues involved in data collection and aggregations are mostly centered around privacy and security issues, as was evident in our earlier discussions. Decision making using data analysis are found to have fatalistic discriminating impact. Failure to identify hidden bias embedded within this collected data and data analysis as well may result imperfect decisions. Now, the imperfect data analysis may lead inaccurate, misleading, and sometimes discriminating outcomes. Erroneous data analysis may cause harm someone at individual level. For example, a person may be denied loan due to errors in credit scoring. Someone's job application may get rejected due to error in automated HR processing. This is an interesting article that you may read to understand the gravity of the issue related to these HR applications. It's very interesting. Now, more seriously, outcome of imperfect data analysis may result social discrimination towards a group of individuals based on their membership of certain groups. Those are often based on race, gender, class, etc. For example, automatic face tagging. The available in various social media platforms have been found to produce discriminating results based on race and gender. In 2015, a software engineer, Jackie Klein, pointed out that the image recognition software used by Google Photos then were classifying his black friends as gorillas. In another such incident, Joy Bulamani, a bright scholar of MIT Media Lab, incidentally a black, observed while working for her graduate thesis that the then most popular facial recognition software that was available in MIT Media Lab was unable to detect her face unless she wears a white mask. In fact, such softwares, the facial recognition softwares in general, perform poorly in detecting faces of darker skinned people compared to lighter skinned people. As another example, according to a report published in 2017 in Sputnik, facial recognition software used by FBI was also found to misidentify minorities as suspects of crime with higher probability. Now, applications of this AI, ML, or big data-based advanced technologies in law enforcement is not limited within the use of facial recognition softwares only. Sophisticated data analytics coupled with complex mathematical models are currently found to be used in predictive policing and criminal justice. For example, commercial tools such as Predpol, Comstat, HunchLab, these are very popular or widely used predictive policing software used by police departments of several US cities. And CMAPS, this is another such kind of tool, is now being used by Delhi police in India. They are found to process historical crime data and use predictive analytics to identify potential criminal activity within a city. Now algorithmic audit performed by various researchers on these systems reveal that almost all of them suffer from lack of transparency because they are mostly work in black box, like a black box. They hardly explain their recommendation, and also found to be undesirably biased against poor and minorities. Now, recidivism tools based on similar technology used by judiciaries for sentencing decisions. They are also found to show such bias. And these tools perform data analysis to compute some kind of risk scores of defendants that indicate their chance to reoffend. And the judges basically use this score to decide whether a defendant would be granted bail or parole or put into the jail. Now, algorithmic audit performed by an investigative nonprofit named ProPublica on a widely used commercial recidivism tool named Compass, developed by North Point, a company, in 2016, shows that it was wrongly labeling black defendants as future criminals at most twice the rate of white defendants. For details study, you may refer the original article available in this link. In fact, risk scores computed by Compass for white defendants were skewed mostly towards lower risk categories, whereas scores for black defendants were skewed towards higher side, and that makes that difference. Now, another study published in 2018 also reveals that sentencing decision is derived based on this risk assessment performed by Compass was no more accurate or fair than predictions that can be made by any layman with little or almost no criminal justice expertise. So in summary, looking at this frightening scope of discrimination, we need to consider these issues very seriously before pervasive deployment of such imperfect systems. That I should point out very clearly. Now, before I conclude this particular session, let me touch upon the ethical issues involved in presentation of final outcomes. That is also a part of decision making in the overall procedure. After the analysis, how the result would be presented. I mean, there are some ethical issues involved therein also. For example, unethical presentation of results is very common in promotion of brands, movies, using some kind of elusive use of statistics. These are very common in advertisement world. Now, I mean, manipulation or misleading presentation of information through social media platforms are nowadays becoming a common trend in politics also, and that is appearing as a threat to democratic systems. And social media platforms were initially appeared to be a useful tool, I mean, to protect democracy, since it allows citizens to get around government censors and establish communication among large group of disparate people across the globe without much effort. And a very fast. Now, but what we have found this difficulty in repressing the spread of information, that which was seen as one of the major strength of social media, unfortunately. The same feature is now making it very difficult to prevent the spread of misinformation. In addition to facilitate the collection and analysis of huge amount of citizens' data, personal data, as you have seen in our earlier discussion, social media platforms are enabling dissemination of propaganda and disinformation. According to the Watchdog's 2019 Freedom on the Net report, populist and far-right leaders have developed skill not only at creating viral disinformation, but also they're developing skill at harnessing networks that disseminate such information. I mean, political parties often employ propaganda armies to distort information and to promote false trends or so-called patriotic trolling using mostly fake accounts created manually or using automated bots. Now, all these facilitate authoritarian leaders to receive undue advantage over their opponents by spreading falsehood about them, gaining up panics about minority groups, and sometimes undermining people's trust in the independent media. I mean, two major recent events. I mean, the 2016 US election and the 2018 Brazilian have bring forward this dangerous potential of such activities. And more menacingly, these are becoming apparent in other parts of the globe. I mean, it's now everywhere, including India. So we need to consider these issues with utmost seriousness. We need to find out ways to deal with this. Thank you.